you're ready.
All right, good morning, everyone. We'll start the board meeting with, join me in the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, thank you. Start out with public comment period. Senator Lang is here and Representative Erdahl.
I don't know if you want to come up at the same time, but.
Well, good morning. You can hold hands, but.
Sure.
Good morning, Mr. Chair and council members. My name is Andrew Lang. I am the, well, first of all, I appreciate the opportunity just to talk to you a little bit as a public member instead of an official capacity as of right now. But I am the senator in your next door district, Candidate County, Swift County, Chippewa, and Renville, excuse me, house where I live in. But after redistricting, the western half, the western one-third of Meeker County.
What do you say, half?
Half. Anything west of pretty much Highway 22 will be in the district that I'm seeking election. So in an effort just to introduce myself and say hello and give you a little information about who I am and what I do, I'm here for you this morning. Currently in the Senate, I sit on both the environment finance, the environment policy, ag finance, ag policy. I'm the chairman of the Veterans Committee in the Senate. And then on a year-round basis, I also sit on the State Emergency Medical Services Regulatory Board that regulates EMS services. And then I sit on the SART Sam's Outdoor Heritage Council, which is a, it's the outdoor heritage to restore, enhance, protect some of the natural resources throughout the state. We spend about a third of the legacy dollars that were voted on in 2008, ends up being about $350 million. So it's a pretty busy job year-round. When I first got elected, they told me it was part-time. But on the civilian side, I work for North Memorial Air Care out of Redwood Falls, and I'm still a member of the Minnesota Army National Guard for a few more years. So I've gone past my 20 now, so we'll see how long they hang on to me. With that being said, I guess I don't have anything specific that I'd like to say other than maybe answer a few questions. Like I said, introduce myself. I grew up in Candy, Ohio, just to the west here, so I have pounded the mean streets of Litchfield a little bit in the past. When I was in my younger years, but Candy, Ohio, graduated from Wilmer High School over 25 years ago, and yeah, I know it's gone fast. Otherwise, yeah, if there's any questions anybody like to ask, anything about the Senate in particular, about the district, how it's really been changing. Meeker County actually has the, I don't know if there's any other counties in the state of Minnesota that have the distinct pleasure of having three different senators running for election in the same county, but that's what's going on now. So it's kind of a weird thing when we go to the
cross
county.
We have to bear.
Yeah, it's a cross we have to bear. Yeah, it's the Meeker County Fair has three different senators, so it's confusing as all get out. But I hope all of you got the letter we sent out this spring just to say hi and my card and my cell phone number. If not. Let me know and I can hand out cards and cell phone numbers and have all my contact information, so it should be available. So yeah, with that, just thanks for the 5 minutes, and if you have any questions of me.
Andrew, just for clarification, District 16.
16, yes, that's correct. So I went from District 17 to District 16, but I never moved. Yeah. And the district, just for some, it was about 80,000 residents from 2010 to 2020. Now it's about 87,000, so we gained about 7,000 residents. Lost Swift County as a whole and picked up the western half of Meeker County. So, and Dean, I don't know if there's anybody else that went west in this redistricting, but Dean is going to be running to the west of where he was in the past. So, I don't know. That's kind of my 2 minute spiel. I don't know if anybody, like I said, I sit on ag and environment committees rather heavily. I do sit on the transportation committee. Did I say that? I don't think I did say that the first time.
On transportation.
Yeah, I sit on transportation, which is a lot of work as well. So the Senate we have, or at least I have had, I've been a freshman, they always call it when you're new. And I had a freshman load all the way into my sophomore year, so I don't know how that happened. But yeah, my class load or my committee load has been rather large, so I'm going to be looking to filter that down a little bit and have a little more free time. But.
On the Senate side, is there still expected a significant turnover come November?
We are. Between Republicans and Democrats, we have 22 seats of the 67 seats that will be retirees or be redistricted and chose not to rerun for election. So it's a significant change in the Senate. Win, lose, or draw, whoever wins these elections is going to be a significant difference on the floor. Minimum 22, I should say that. Mm-hmm. It might bump up. It'll be an interesting year.
We've got 7-8 House members running for the Senate. Mm-hmm. We like to say we're sending our best and our brightest.
I have a comment for that. I just let it go.
So yeah, I don't know. Any other questions? I'm more than willing to. Any other council members? Be quiet. Hopefully see you soon.
All right. Thank you. Always good to be here. I don't think I have to introduce myself too much to you guys, since I've been doing this for 20 years. my district, as the senator said, changed. I go west. I used to border the metro area when I had Wright County townships, and now I can almost see South Dakota from the end of my district. I have half of Meeker. I've got the Lake Lillian corner of Candy, Ohio, and then all of Renville and all of Chippewa. So Milan, Montevideo, that's all in my district now. I serve on capital investment, that's the bonding committee, legacy and education policy. I'll continue my fight for civics education in the next session of the legislature. Bonding, that's where I am the Republican lead, and if things go the way we hope, I'll be the chair of the committee in the next biennium. We are still looking at trying to get some things done with bonding. In the bill that we just almost did, as the Republican lead, I put into that bill more money for local roads and bridges than ever before in the state history, more money for Public Facilities Authority, the water projects than had ever been done before, local projects like we did pass $5 million for the Litchfield Wellness Center. I had some more funding in there for that. We had $5 million for the renovation of the historic buildings downtown, money for CCAP, for other cities in Meeker County and Litchfield, helping with the funding for that. $10 million for the enhancement of Litchfield's wastewater treatment plant, dealing with the demands of increased demand in First District. So there are a lot of important things that have been done in bonding for this area and need to be done, could yet be done. Who knows? After the election, we may come back for a special session. It's a possibility. I wouldn't bet a whole lot on it, but that could happen. And if it does, the things that I just outlined for you likely will happen. If not now, then the next session. So that's what I've been doing, what I'm planning on doing, in a thumbnail sketch of it. So any questions on anything?
Representative Erdl, next year normally is not a bonding year, correct?
Right.
So do you think there's a possibility that this is going to come up next year so that some of these items can move?
Yes, and that's the silver lining for you and me.
I'll jump in. I'll say the silver lining is that we want to get a bonding bill done early in session. We always say that, but this time it's teed up to happen that way. Depending on how the election goes is exactly what the way that bonding bill looks. The reason
the silver lining for me is that if it happens, we because we didn't do one this biennium. Usually we do two the next biennium. Last time when I was chair, we didn't do a bonding bill in 2016. So when I became chair in 2017 and 2018, we did major bonding bills each year. And so if we don't get one done yet this year, and again, things go the way I kind of think and hope they will, you'll have me as the chair of the bonding committee for two bonding bills in a row.
Okay. That's a big deal for Western Minnesota.
Yes.
That's really inside baseball, but it doesn't make it any less true. And actually the bonding bill that it came on, even the one that came off the floor this, or, well, sat on the floor of the Senate.
It was good.
Pretty good.
And, you know, for those that, you know, maybe don't have a real full understanding, the reason that we bond is for the public buildings, the public property of the state of Minnesota. It is our responsibility as a legislature to take care of the property that the state of Minnesota owns. And frankly, also to help to keep down local property taxes. Because if a new water tower is needed, if a new wastewater treatment plant is needed, if the state didn't bond to do it, then the local taxpayers would have to pay for it. And so they still do. We usually require a 50% match. So there is that buy-in from the locals as well. But without it, without bonding, without taking care of what we own as the state of Minnesota, it would be much more expensive for the local people.
And gentlemen, I have one question. Well, Representative Erdahl, you're 16A to your new district.
I am 16A, yes.
16A, for reference. And then for both of you, I sit on the Vice Chair of Public Safety Policy Committee, and we just had our district meeting fall conference last week in Alexandria. And when you sit in that room and you ask everybody in the room who needs deputies, corrections officers, and dispatchers, you know, 80 hands go up and there's only 40 people in the room because everybody's that short. And all we're doing is cannibalizing from one another. And the sheriff sits here and, you know, needs positions and can't find them, and it also lowers the quality of those positions. What is there anything that you're seeing in the state, or who do we need to talk to at state level to try and change the dynamic that we have facing us? Because it's, nobody has an answer.
Right.
In them committee meetings, hey, you know, you got 30 people going through training, or you had 150 3-4 years ago, and there's a significant problem to every county.
But there's a couple of things, and this is a problem that goes throughout the state of Minnesota. Right? The state patrol right now, I think, in their graduating class is like 17 short of even fulfilling a graduating class, which is unheard of. State patrol always had to cut their classes about in half to get them all graduated. Same thing goes, you know, from Wilmer PD in the past. I talked to Jim Felton. You know, we used to have 100 applicants for two jobs. Now we get 10, maybe. So we did have a bill that was called COPS, of course. It was an acronym for something I didn't remember, but you know, wasn't exactly the most difficult acronym out there. But what it did, it was talking about recruiting and retention, you know, picking up some of those kids coming out of high school when it comes to, hey, if you go into law enforcement career, you're going to pay for some of your tuition, some of that skills training that goes on, maybe supply some sort of stipend while you go to make it a little easier to become a police officer. Also included in that was some of the, if you've ever known what the transition program is, when you're a person has a 4-year degree and you want to become a law enforcement officer, that particular program has looked at with a little bit of scrutiny since the Muhammad Noor case, because that was a program he went through. But overall, I think it's fairly successful when you have an educated person that was going to go through the program. And it goes through a high-intensity one-semester program for all the law enforcement. I think it's 22, 23 credits. It's pretty extensive. And then they go into skills, and then they go into law enforcement. And then we talk about retention of some of the senior officers, right? Some of those guys that are in their mid-50s and have the most experience and are thinking, I'm done with this, I'm tapping out, like, what is it going to take for us to keep you around? And that bill addressed a lot of that thing, like increasing retirement at a pretty rapid rate at 55 plus years old, looking at some additional 401k matching and things like that that really makes it worthwhile to stick out another 5 years senior, when you're a senior officer. But truthfully, you got to address the elephant in the room, right? Like, law enforcement has taken such a beating, realistically, on a, well, on every platform, let's just say, and definitely undeserved. And I think that's going to take some time for recovery. I think it's going to take some time for those high school kids, those college kids, to really move back into law enforcement career and say, hey, these are some of our best and brightest. How do we continue to do that? So we've taken steps. I think society needs to take a step now, hopefully. I don't know. That's a really big question.
I think the senator covered a lot of the issues there, attraction, retention, just making the job more attractive. I mean, it's getting a lot of black eyes right now. I did have a bill that I worked on with Sheriff Cruz, relatively small budget item, but still bothersome to them, that is the cost of extradition, where local law enforcement has to go into other states and bring people back, and the cost is borne then by the sheriff department, the sheriff's department, their budget. And I did have a bill that went through the House, the Senate too. It should have happened, but at the end of the line, the chair of the House committee was trying to hold it up for some trade bait for something else. Well, I think it would have happened. I think that it would have passed, that the state would have covered part of this cost, but it didn't. For the same reason that almost everything didn't happen at the end of the last session. But I will say that if the chair of the committee is Brian Johnson instead of Carlos Mariani, there'll be a different attitude towards some of these things. And no matter who has control of the legislature, Carlos Mariani is retired, so he won't be there.
All right. Sheriff, do you have anything to add? I mean, this is the tough stuff that we're dealing with out here. So,
that's getting really into the weeds.
Any other questions? Gentlemen, I appreciate it.
Thank you for the time.
Thank you.
Senator Lang, if you do have a contact information.
I actually just write it down. I sent letters out, but
I don't recall it.
We will resend.
Otherwise, I will.
I also have a copy of his contact information I can send out to the whole board as well.
There you go.
Okay.
All right. We're
okay.
Thank you.
Take care.
All right, moving along. Item B, September 2022 board meeting agenda.
No additions. No additions.
No changes.
Move to approve the agenda.
Motion by Commissioner Johnson.
Second.
Second by Commissioner Schiefelbein. Any discussion?
Did we ask if there were other people who had public comment?
You know what? I don't.
No.
I was too long-winded.
Do we have...
Is there anybody else for public comment?
All right.
No, nobody else. Okay.
Thank you.
No.
Sorry about that.
I didn't know anybody else.
Good catch. Any other discussion on the agenda? Not hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Motion carried. Next item, consent agenda. Andrew, if you walk us through that. And this is, we do have a resolution here, so this will be a roll call.
Yep, we have approval of the September 6th board meeting minutes, approval of social services, county and hospital accounts payable, approval to hire full-time dispatcher Amber Hine, level B22, step 1, $20.94 an hour, effective September 26th. Approval of temporary liquor license for the American Legion for October 15th at the fairgrounds. Approval of the hire of full-time building official Brian Fehrenbach, level C45, step 9, of $42.22 an hour, effective October 3rd. Approval to hire casual part-time public health nurse Eileen Nelson for CPR instruction to public health staff. Approval of final acceptance and payment for the 2022 pavement crack sealing contract. Approval and acceptance of payment for intersection lighting project SP 047-070013. Resolution 2022-31, appointing Dr. Quinn Piper as the medical examiner, and approval of an agreement. And that concludes the consent agenda.
Are there any items in there anyone wishes to discuss?
I just found it amusing that we bought wooden nickels. $172.
What in the world?
I know what it's for and where it was going, and but it just kind of looked funny.
Yeah, wooden nickels. I did have on the intersection lighting project. Now, that whole ball got rolling before some of us newbies got on the board. But since this was completed, I've had a number of people contact me and thank the board for putting up these various intersection lighting projects. So it's been very well received. People are appreciating it.
And that they were appreciating it before you were a newbie board too. So it's been a popular.
Yep. So. Good comments on that.
All right. Anything else in the consent agenda? If you're not, I'd have Corey take the roll, please.
We don't have a motion.
Nope.
Mr. Chair, move to approve the consent agenda.
Motion by Paul.
Second.
Second by Julie. Mm-hmm. Now, Corey.
Commissioner Schiefelbein.
Yes.
Commissioner Bredesen.
Yes.
Commissioner Johnson.
Yes.
Commissioner Schmidt.
Yes. Next item, Diane Winter, Public Health Director.
Good morning, Diane Winter from Public Health. Included in your board packet was a summary of a request to hire a full-time county case manager. Public Health case manages a target population for Prime West, and this particular request was also included and approved in the 2023 budget. But what has happened since then, in addition to their caseloads increasing, we had a full-time nurse who functioned half-time in family health and held a half-time case management caseload. She resigned effective last Friday, and there just is no capacity within that two-member team to take that additional caseload on. So I'm requesting to have that case manager hired now rather than waiting for the starting January year in the 2023 budget. And this position is reimbursed through Prime West based on the category of the individual they're serving, either by capitation or fee for service.
All right. Anybody have any questions for Diane? If not, I'd look for a motion to approve for her to recruit.
I'll make that motion.
Motion by Commissioner Bredesen.
Second.
Second by Commissioner Schiefelbein. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Motion carried.
All right, thank you.
Thank you, Diane. Good luck.
Very happy. Yeah.
Good luck to you. Mikkel Johnson, Human Resources.
Good morning.
Mikkel Johnson, Human Resources Coordinator. I'm here to seek approval of Humana as a county dental insurance carrier for 2023 to 2024. The dental is 100%, the premium is 100% paid for by the employee. And I was hearing from employees that they were hoping that we could look for dental that did not include the preventative care cost in the maximum benefit. So for instance, on our current carrier, if they go in for their cleanings and say they have a $1,000 maximum benefit, Cleaning can be about $200, so that would come out of that $1,000. So I asked our ancillary benefit broker to go out for proposals. We received several proposals, and then we met with the health insurance committee, and overall the decision to recommend was Humana, as they're offering a 12% reduction in premiums and a 2-year rate guarantee with that. They do not include the preventative care costs in the overall maximum benefit, so they would have that as an enhancement. They also provide 3 cleanings per year as compared to 2. And they also, on the high plan, offer a 30% coinsurance once the annual maximum benefit has been met. They would still offer 30% coinsurance over that, which is pretty unheard of as far as what our ancillary broker said. So the one downside with Humana is that on the low plan, it does not cover basic oral surgery, which would be your basic extractions. So we would be losing that benefit on the low plan. So we would just encourage employees that if they have more dental needs, that they should seek the high plan. But overall, there would be a reduction, which is always really nice. And so the employees on the health insurance committee recommended that we go with Humana.
And that was guaranteed for the 2-year.
2 years.
Yeah, for 2 years.
Yeah, when it was explained, I mean, this is kind of a no-brainer. I mean, 12% decrease in a 2-year lock, and all your bennies are still there. I think it's good for the employees.
Okay. Any other questions?
Move to approve Humana as the county's dental insurance carrier for 2023-2020.
Motion by Paul.
Second.
Second by Danny. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Motion carried.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mikel. Do you want to...
You probably should do the public
hearing. That's what I was going to ask if we'll jump. We're just about 9 o'clock, so we'll probably... jump up to item number 7 on the agenda, public hearing to consider. Do we need a motion to recess county board?
Typically, no.
Okay. Well, then I'm going to recess county board, and we will convene as a county ditch authority. And with that, we'll move to the public hearing to consider rescinding an order of judicial ditch 17.
Before we begin... we have connections with our 2 remote people.
I am working
on it. Anyone have to announce that they're on?
I'm working on it right now.
So joining us remotely for this Judicial 17 request to rescind will be Terry Reagan from Hauser, as well as Tom Lanzel. We also have in the audience representing Cadillac County, Lauren Engelby, and then Johnny myself, and I'll carry this. Steve is the judicial board chair, so it's unique that he's also the board chair today.
All right.
Steve, I believe Danny is not part of this board.
Oh, okay.
You still have quorum with the 3.
You still have quorum.
You're on break.
Oh, I'm on break. All right. I'll take 5 then.
This one. Okay. So we did reach out to Mr. Anderson from Kennedy, Ohio County, so he's aware. And Lauren is here to speak on behalf of Kennedy if we need that.
And a majority is needed, but not a supermajority.
Okay.
Correct.
should be here then. Yep, we should be ready to go.
All right, we will open the public hearing for Joint Ditch 17. John Conan, our representative, Mr. Engen of the Soil, Water and Conservation District, and Bowser provide an overview of what happened and why the change is being requested of the board's final order.
Sir, Steve, Soil and Water is also here.
Yeah, I noticed
so
that.
So which one of them is speaking?
I don't know if Tom or Terry would want to speak, otherwise I could.
I'll let you guys organize the facts how you want them presented.
Go ahead, Terry.
That muted?
Have volume.
Looks muted.
Yes. Somebody's muted.
Oh.
She's not muted on this end.
And they hear us. Technical difficulties. Your break is getting longer.
Yeah. Go and have some more bananas.
Yeah.
Technology, but
nothing is muted.
Yeah, maybe you can serve refreshments.
Well, no, really?
Pass it around.
I don't know if hospitality is my thing.
Agreed.
Agreed.
Not your strong.
No, point. Probably my strong point.
That's what I thought. Yeah. I could hear it real faint.
Yeah. Terry, can you hear us? Terry, can you hear us?
Yes.
That's through the computer. Yeah.
Sorry, we're still...
Is this the first ditch I worked on after becoming a commissioner? Or was that 19?
Oh, 51 was the big one that we when we first came on. This one...
Oh, it was still before you started.
Yeah.
I see it dates back to...
But the one you're thinking of was 51. Was the very, like, 4 days in.
Yeah.
To your job. 5th of January.
And a high dollar one. Is that cool?
Terry, can you try again?
But 17 has been, work has been being done on that for quite some time.
A couple different projects.
Yeah.
Terry, can you just try talking again real quick?
So, Vice Chair Schmidt, how does it feel being Chair Olberg for the day?
Well, so far I only screwed up a couple times. Forgot to ask for the vote.
A couple comments they could make. But probably should refrain from them.
I would think less if you don't.
Yeah. We'll let it go, though.
why don't you go ahead and we'll
then they can add any comments that discrepancies or whatever.
And before John starts on the agenda, I guess I didn't recognize him or just mentioned, we do have to identify publicly that we did the notice requirements. So for both Meeker and Candy Ojai, every individual on this system was notified along with all of the key parts that that were involved, Bowser. And I failed to mention that Josh Palmier is here from Soil and Water as well. So all the notices were done per requirements.
Right.
Did we officially, it's Tom Wenzel and Terry Reagan are the Bowser representatives that are on the line for the record as well? Okay. John, we'll let you get.
All right, started. There is a finding in order granting request for Richard Engen and Meeker County Soil and Water to modify a portion of Meeker Canyon JD-17 that was approved October 6th. 2020, that included a new, proposed title reroute for the Wincongan project. So there was a new easement put on that reroute. And there was part of branch two. And while I was actually out there on site when they did this, when they exposed the tile ended up being approximately 2 feet lower than what they anticipated in their plans. So it was not going to work for the project to occur. So the reroute did not happen. We just basically patched up the tile and put it back up. So there was no reroute, never happened. Nothing changed with the original tile. So why we're here today is to rescind that order granting the new easement. So we're getting rid of that easement and then we're reinstating the easement going back over the old line, essentially, is what we're doing. I think that pretty well sums it up, Lorna.
Yep.
So basically, because of the difference in elevation, once the tile covered it,
it wasn't
forfeited covered. That project because the rest of the facts won't work.
Yep.
So we're just rescinding that.
The new easement that was acquired, and then we're just putting the old easement.
Okay. All right. Is there anything to add?
Mr. Chair, I may add.
Lauren?
This was one very small portion of the total project, so this is the rest of the project went off without a hitch, and it worked very, very well. So this is just one small portion of that large project, and but it's a very nice project.
Okay.
And then my comment at this point on the open floor just answers questions. Gil also indicates, assuming the board approves the draft finding in order, which we're going to talk about here from their office, they will coordinate in preparing a release of the old easement and grant a new easement along the original alignment where the tile is currently installed. So this will restore the records to manageable points.
So this is a county tile that...
Correct.
I mean, just so I'm clear that... This is a county tile, not a private tile.
Yeah,
right. Okay. It's part of the judicial system.
Okay. All right. All right.
I see a number B that the Mr. Engen will be responsible for all costs associated with this.
This particular project has been a billable project as we went along, as Lauren commented, so this will be a billable action to the system.
Okay.
All right, is there any other questions? Julie or Paul? Anything? And do we know if Tom or Terry have anything to add or?
Were we able to capture them on the?
They can hear us.
They've been able to hear what?
We can't hear them.
So they've sent no emails with questions or?
Nothing.
Okay.
Okay.
All right. So we would look. You need a few different motions on this one, correct?
Should open it for public comment as well.
Okay.
I thought
follow the agenda there. I think that'll help you guys.
Okay. All right, so there's nothing further to add, so we'll open the floor to public comments, and I think we have a landowner in the room if he'd care to public. Would you like to make a public comment on it, or are you just here for?
I guess I don't understand where we're at. I just have a map that they sent me when they...
Lauren will guide you.
For the record, is he an adjacent landowner or just someone on the ditch system?
Lauren, okay. You want to come up to the microphone with them?
Or hand them. Or hand them.
John, which type, what number is it?
Now, this is a different project.
Yeah,
that's the Swanson project.
And I didn't bring my map. Josh, you have any maps regarding this project?
No,
The tile was on whose property?
On Engen's property.
It was all on Engen's
property. Everything that was to be done was on Engen's property.
Sure.
Map of.
That's a different project.
Yep.
Yeah, I didn't recognize them.
I'm just downstream, that's all.
Okay.
Yeah, that tile's on the very upstream end of the entire ditch.
Yeah.
So, Steve, I believe that Lauren and John could probably work with this individual outside of this here public hearing, being identified that it's outside of this hearing.
Sure.
Just shortly after this.
Okay. All right.
And Mr. Chair, just so you're aware, Terry did send a message over team saying that he didn't have any additional comments. No All additional right. comments.
All right.
Mr. Chairman, one quick comment. I think it's important to note that for all property owners or anybody who's listening or interested, is that this change in the project will not affect anyone's drainage benefits upstream or downstream. So this is a very simple yet necessary process that we need to go through, but it's important to know that it will not affect anyone's drainage, good or bad.
Okay. I appreciate that, Lauren. Any other public comments? Hearing none, we'll close the public comment portion, and then does this board have any other questions?
I guess I have one, just because I'm still learning about all of these different ditch things. Why would Mr. Engen be billed for this and not disperse those costs among all property owners like most of the work is?
Because it was a petition filed and petitions for like impoundments or reroutes, stuff like that. All those expenses are incurred by the landowner or the person.
The individual.
By the individual filing the petition.
I see. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Chairman, Commissioner, the drainage law does say that a petitioner is responsible for costs associated to items in that petition. I do believe and I hope that when Mr. Engen receives this bill that Bowser will have program dollars to help. I don't know that for sure, but
you're correct.
Okay, good.
Yep. He'll submit the invoices to the Stormwater District, and then the district will turn into the Bowser to reimburse Mr. Engen.
Good. So that's program dollars. Also program dollars that paid for restoration, the construction, and associated costs. So that's good to hear.
Thank you.
And Julie, for your information, costs to this point have been billed and have been reimbursed. So these are new developments that we will be doing additional billing for.
Okay. Good.
So we will not need to continue this public hearing.
I don't believe new issues have developed, and I think you can move past six.
Okay. At that point, then I would look for the board. We can approve the draft findings and order granting request to rescind the October 6, 2020 drainage system ordered by motion and roll call vote.
So moved.
Motion by Commissioner Bredesen.
Second.
Second by Commissioner Johnson. And that will be a roll call vote.
Commissioner Schiefelbein?
Yes.
No.
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 He's a
special, oh,
there's a
sorry.
List.
On this you're one. Still on vacation.
Yeah, I know.
It's
I
just the three.
Commissioner Johnson?
Commissioner Johnson, do you want to take the roll then?
Yeah, that would
be yes.
Commissioner Anderson is noted to be absent from Candy Ojai. Commissioner Olberg from Meeker noted to be absent. Commissioner Bredesen?
Yes.
And Commissioner Schmidt?
Yes. And our next item would be the board to acknowledge the previous meeting minutes from December 3rd, 2019, December 17th, 2019, April 8th, 2021, June 8th, 2021, and August 16th, 2022.
So moved, Mr. Chair.
Motion by Commissioner Johnson.
Second.
Second by Commissioner Bredesen. This can just be a majority vote.
That's correct. Now, the reason that we're bringing all these minutes is because when we have official meetings of a drainage authority, we are to take minutes of that. That's outside of the county board. We're using that time slot. And these minutes had not been officially acknowledged by the judicial board. And so I'm bringing that standard up to the meeting up today. So yes, it's just a regular vote.
Well, and that would also tie all this rescission
exactly
to those minutes, so it's easy to track history that way. And we'll take the vote. All in favor of acknowledging the previous minutes as stated, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Motion carried. Is there anything further?
Not for the joint board.
For the joint board?
That you are still in recess, I would assume, from the county board. Do you want to continue ditch items or go back to the county?
Yes, we will.
So I think with the closing of this issue in JB 17, we'll make sure that we work with the landowner that was here so that he has his questions answered. But in the ditch authority, John would have the first item on the agenda.
Do we need to, do I need a motion? To close J
17, yes.
Yep. Okay, I'll look for a motion to adjourn joint ditch 17.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Commissioner Bredesen, second by Commissioner Johnson. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Joint ditch 17 is adjourned. We'll now continue with county ditch items on the agenda. John?
All right, the first item I bring to you this morning is approval for a quote for purchase of some culverts for some crossing repairs on County Ditch 15. There's multiple crossings that are in need of repair. We've been through a lot of the meetings already. You guys are aware of a lot of that stuff. There was one landowner requesting that two of the crossings be repaired this fall, if at all possible. He's got two different properties that are landlocked. He has permission from his neighbor to get into his fields, but he has to work around his neighbors, like planting, harvest, and all that schedules. Like this year, with the tough spring, he never got in and planted any of those. And being we got Joe's repair report, we had recommended sizes, elevations, and all that. So I started the process of doing that. I got a quote for two culverts. I've also reviewed this already with the DNR, being that it does affect a protected waterway basin. Regarding Joe's recommendation, they are already good with that, so we're good to go on that part of it. But I did get a quote from True North Steel for two 60-inch culverts that are 32 feet long. The cost for those two culverts was $13,528.88. That's including delivery of the culverts. That's state bid pricing on those. The installation of these culverts will be done by MSB Excavating. Work would be completed, time and materials. My approximate estimation on that would be about $68,000 for having those installed. looking for a motion to approve the purchase of the two culverts.
Can you get them, John? I mean, are they available? Or is this one of these things that's gonna get caught up in the supply side of things?
The sooner we get an order, the better chance we have of getting them. Who knows how long it'll take.
But if we approve this, that will lock in the price with them?
Yeah.
The, so these are additional crossings.
These would be ones that would be repaired either way on the repair, you know, like Joe's got his repair report. These are two crossings that would be repaired either way. So they're currently there. One's completely washed out and the other one, I would even question taking my side by side across it in that kind of condition.
Okay, so they are, I mean, I just, anytime, I mean, this is my layman's terms, but anytime you add pipe in a ditch, I'm just looking at additional. If we're moving and relocating to make it work better for landowners, I got no
problem. We're putting them in the same location.
Okay.
Completely out of repair.
Okay.
For use anyway.
All right. Julie, do you have any concerns? Dan? You're back off break.
Yeah. I was waiting for the nod. Mr. Chair, I make a motion to approve the quote from True North Steel for two 60-inch by 32 feet long steel culverts in amount of $13,528.88.
Motion by Dan.
I will second that motion.
Second by Paul. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Motion carried. Thanks, John. Barb?
Along with County Ditch 15, remember that you have that public hearing on Tuesday, next Tuesday. This likely will be part of John's presentation with the entire group in Bassel. Okay, then moving on to the next item that I have for the Ditch Authority, and that is to consider loan requests. We do have funds again being requested both directions, paying back loans and ordering loans. So the mid-year assessments did certify County Ditch 17 and 19. We weren't able to do that at the beginning of the year, but repayments have now allowed me to retire portions of those loans. So County Ditch 17, $35,000 plus interest. County Ditch 19, $20,000 plus interest. Recent work on County Joint Ditch number one makes it necessary for us to obtain a loan in the amount of $160,000. We will be paying one of the bills today, which is $58,000, and the other one will likely be on the next meeting for October, which is about $60,000, so that fund can't obviously handle that. $75,000, it's got up to my amount. But anyway, that particular ditch, once we go through the percentages and sharing our bills and doing the certification, the end result is that Meeker County will only be 10.77%. Canby, Ohio will be the larger portion of the remaining, and there's a very small amount that will go to Randall County when we do the billing. So I expect this loan to be short-term on this particular one. We did have the loans previously at 3%, and I'm requesting that this loan be considered at 3% also. So with that, we have two motions. One is to make the repayment to revenue from ditch, and that will be for the two that were retiring, 17 and 19, and then also a second motion to authorize the new loan and authorize that at the suggested 3% interest.
Do we take these individually?
I think we should, so that the identification is clear.
All right.
I move to approve transferring funds from ditch to revenue to retire loans for $55,000 plus interest for ditches 17 and 19.
Motion by Commissioner Bredesen.
Second.
Second by Commissioner Schiefelbein. Any further discussion on the loans? Hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carried. Next item.
You're on a roll, Julie.
Here we go. Move to approve ditch loan from revenue fund for ditch joint ditch number one of $160,000 at 3% interest.
Motion, Commissioner Bredesen.
Second.
Second, Commissioner Schiefelbein. Any further discussion or questions on the loan? Hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carried.
That concludes our agenda items. Thank you.
All right, thank you, and we will adjourn the County Ditch Authority and reconvene the county board. Next item up is item Dana Burmeister, Field Service Manager, South. All right, oh, here we go.
Yep.
Sure. Looks great. Good morning.
Good morning. Thank you for having us. My name is Dana Burmeister. I'm a regional manager for the Department of Corrections, and I supervise 8 districts in the southern half of the state. And I appreciate you letting us be flexible with the schedule. I wanted to get my new Chaska district supervisor on board, and so I'd like to introduce you to Sean McMonagle. He just started in August, and he will be supervising Mary Jean. So that's why we wanted him to be here at the board for this presentation.
Hello, thank you guys for having us.
Yep.
So I think, oh, go ahead. And Mary Jean, I think you know everyone. I made sure, I'm like, do they all know you? Yes. So do you all have a copy of the data that we had printed out for you? Okay, so I just want to draw some attention to some of the points. It was important to be able to provide since the beginning of the contract, but then to give that historical perspective before COVID. Because we know that that has greatly impacted many of our STS programs. So just to highlight the average crew size that is listed here in this graph about midpoint down does not include Mary Jean's hours. Those are only, and this is in the top graph about, it's one of the blue categories there, yep, average crew size. Those do not include Mary Jean's hours. However, the total hours worked at the very bottom of that graph does include Mary Jean's hours. So just to draw attention to that. Also, the market value, estimated market value, is what we ask the crew leaders to give a projection of what that work would cost if it were to be hired out or completed by someone else, you know, a county employee or, you know, county had to hire it done. And so this is something that I have talked with Mary Jean about because I think she's providing some very low estimates with her work. So what we talked about is if it's an actual project where you have a start and an end date and it's not something that is reoccurring that you do on a regular basis, call a person that does that type of work and get an actual bid so it's something that we can have an actual estimate of what it would cost, and then it's virtually, you know, free to the county. Projects that are ongoing, such as the lawn mowing and so on, that can be a bid from the county on what it would cost the county if they were to have to hire a worker. And I think, what did you say, you do like $20 an hour or something, you know, normally?
That's when I work for city entities. Okay. We should adjust that too as well. I mean, that's kind
of... So I think what I'm trying to say is those are pretty lean estimates of the work that is completed by STS. The middle graph shows the total hours worked from the beginning of our fiscal year 20 through today. And with this one, I will just point out quarter three, fiscal year 22 has lower total hours worked, and that is because Mary Jean was out for a period of time for medical issues. So I just want to, that's kind of a exception right there. And then the bottom graph with the average crew size, I've noted some of the issues that we were forced to, you know, restrictions that we were able or were forced to place on the crews during COVID. And so those began right away in March of 2020. And we actually suspended crews for those 3 months All of our crew leaders continued to work, but they worked independently, and so, you know, that obviously impacted the crew sizes. And then just in the beginning of March of 22 is when we finally resumed normal operations, raising the limit that we could transport in our vans from 2 to however many we can get on crew these days. So that's what I have for you on there.
Chair, if I may.
Yeah, absolutely.
Thank you. Just, I think, an important piece that was unique to Meeker County is I remember reviewing during COVID, we authorized, I think, the previous county administrator authorized that we have individuals working over at the landfill during that time. And so I think we were unique in that we actually did have crews working, but they were independent over at the landfill. So those numbers should be included in here as well.
Yes.
So we did have workers during COVID.
And we did allow, if clients had their own transportation, they could meet at a work site where we were able to social distance, but we only allowed up to two to be transported in the vans and, you know, had to space them and had barriers and that kind of thing. And so, yeah, that definitely impacted it. With the breakdown of the hours where Mary Jean works at, in that top graph again, because the county pays 75% of the program, 75% of the hours should be done for the county, and I think that you can see that that, I believe, has been met, maybe not in the month that, or the quarter she was gone, but most of the other ones, I would say, they're she's met or exceeded that percentage. So. And, you know, you can see since the crews resumed, we are seeing a bit of an upswing in the average crew size, but that is absolutely something that we do need to discuss. I'm going to be visiting with Les and hopefully some of the agents. And it just comes down to the referrals. We need the referrals from the agents. We need the judge to be ordering STS. STS can be a consequence in and of itself. It can be done in lieu of fines. It can be done in lieu of jail. But we need the referrals. So the agents can do it as a sanction to correct behavior. They can recommend it in a probation violation. And they can also recommend it as part of the PSI. So that's something that we're working on. Questions?
How do we get participants to want to have these folks come and work their hours? I know we have cooperation with the like the food shelf and some of those places. How do those folks come to us, or do you reach out to them?
And you're talking about how do we get work sites?
Sure.
Actually, people, they'll usually contact me, and then we can set something up, like for their need. You know, if they need, like if they're going to have a changeover at the Threads of Hope, they'll say, could you have a crew come on, you know, this date and this date? But, I mean, I'm open if they just call me, and we try to accommodate what they need. I don't go search out, but I make myself available in case they might need, they don't know I'm a resource, then I do kind of extend that way too. I'll be honest with you all, say, well, you know, this is something that my program could help you with.
Thank you.
And work for any, we'll do work for any nonprofit, city, county, municipality type townships. And we do have crew leaders that do seek out, you know, if work sites are slow or whatever, they'll go look for work. Most of the time, the crew leaders have pretty well established work sites. The counties alone generally, I mean, when the fair comes to town, and I mean, they generally are pretty busy with those kinds of things, but we absolutely will look for work if you know, people are needing our help. On our Department of Corrections website, we do have a place that people can put in for if they have an STS project where they want to see if it's appropriate. And I monitor those. I actually monitor the STS program for the state. So we have 26 crews right now that run statewide. And so when those come in, I look at them, and if they're appropriate, if they're one of our crews, I'll send it to the crew leader, and if they're not one of our crews and they have a county program running, I'll send it to that county and let them know about it. So,
okay, thank you.
Yeah. Well, question, I had one clarification. Do we, is this all adults, or is there a juvenile part of this too? It is as well. Okay. We just had our public safety committee meeting up in Alex last week, and this topic was talked about a lot. Minnesota ranks 50th in community supervision. Nationally, the average is 5% of dollars that goes into community supervision. Minnesota puts about 2.5%. With that, we have the highest offense rate, or fifth highest in the nation. And 60% of crime is done by recidivism. Is that, would you agree with that, county attorney? I mean, Andrew sent out a graphic 10 days ago or so on the cost of this program to the county outside of Mary Jean's wage of about $25,000. Is that accurate?
The cost, what we've budgeted for the cost of this program is $80,000 for next year.
Yes.
Yes.
But that includes
Mary Jean. That is, yeah.
And I guess everything in one other graphic that they had last week, one juvenile who gets into hot water, I will say, in 1998 taxpayer dollars, one juvenile has an estimated cost of $1.4 million in taxpayer cost if they don't get straightened out. So this is I know this, the numbers have been down, but everything that the state is looking to do too through public safety directs more this way versus incarceration. And I think right now the missing piece is the connection between the judges and how mandatory or how, you know, that's affecting Mary Jean's numbers on her work crews. But it seems to me everything I'm hearing and seeing is that is going to change in the future because of the data that's being brought forth, because they don't like to incarcerate as much as they possibly can. They want to get into that to rehabilitation and catching them early on and trying to get them on a straightforward path. So, I mean, to me, it's hard for me to argue against this program.
Whose responsibility is it to help publicize this to our judges? Is it our attorneys? Is it your responsibility? Who tells them these numbers and says, here's an alternative option when you're giving out a sentence?
It does fall to us, I believe. But it's also, I mean, public defenders and county attorneys can, you know, remind and
sure,
make that part of plea agreements or whatever. Like I said, if it's in lieu of jail, it's a great alternative. You know, for people that aren't employed, it teaches them at least that work ethic. You got to get up. You got to get to the van on time. You got to be there on the days that you're supposed to report. You know, so at least we're teaching them something. You know, for those that are working, Mary Jean does a lot of independent placement so that we are not interfering with their work. We don't want them to lose jobs because they have to complete STS. But for the juveniles, same thing. You know, it's teaching them something. Getting along with adults and having to work with people in the community. So,
and this will be emphasized with our judges now going forward.
Do you have corrections advisory board?
No, we don't at this time.
Here? Okay.
And you'll have to correct me if I'm wrong here because I'm still learning, because not every county is a DOC county. DOC counties, we have county probation counties that are use a county probation, and then the other one is CCA, which is community corrections. So there's three different programs, and I think that is part of the challenge is the messaging. how each program is funded. That's part of the problem with funding them, and that's probably why we're dead last nation. But it's, and they're trying to address all that and to bring this together where if the legislature can't understand it, you're not getting dollars. I mean, it's that simple. If they don't understand the language, they're not going to stick their neck out to vote on something or promote something that they don't understand. So that's where the dollars fall short. But I think the other caveat we have is the three programs and trying to identify to the legislature these three programs. They're all work a little bit differently. I'm sure there's, you know, arguments for and against of each one, strengths and weaknesses. I think it's, you know, trying to get that message in, and I don't know from a county attorney standpoint with the judges, you know, there's always, you got the judicial branch and the legislative branch and trying to make that communication between Sheriff's Association and County Attorney's Association and county supervision, you know, and making these arguments and get them all together in one page. And actually, that's that one work group that I'm sitting on is exactly that. We have Jake McClellan's in there, and county probation, and community corrections, and two commissioners from, there's like 20 of us in there, and that's one of our topics is to bring this together and get it to the legislator in a pretty package that they can understand and get some funding behind, because the dollars are not there for any of it. Doesn't matter what the program is. So I'm not exactly sure how to communicate to the judges the importance but I think the argument is they want to keep people employed. George Thorogood too.
Yeah.
It was on Do Not Disturb.
So there's some communication gaps, yep. But they're trying to address that.
Because I'm wondering if every time a judge has an opportunity to set down a sentence on someone, let's say I get a speeding ticket, would I have that option? I don't want to pay it, or I don't have the money to pay it. Can I participate in this? And I'm assuming that there are regulations. You can't probably have someone who did a violent act. They maybe need to be incarcerated. But other folks, is that an option for every person who goes through our legal system to participate in this?
So for STS can be done in lieu of fines.
Okay.
I will say that it kind of depends on how the court administrator's office works, because I don't know how many years back, 6 years back or so, they started working with the collections agencies. And so if the client doesn't go, you know, directly to court admin and set up a payment plan or set a time frame of when they're going to pay it, they'll just send it to collections automatically. And once they do that, then we can't do STS for that fine. So that's one of the things that's really hurt our program. I mean, I don't think they did it intentionally, but that was the impact of it. And so, you know, that is one of the things that we, you know, tell people is visit with court admin right away. Let them know that you'd like to do STS instead, or talk to the county attorney or your public defender and let them know that you don't have the money and you'd like to have that option. And so that is an option, but people have to be aware of it.
Yeah. The awareness piece.
Yes.
Quick comment. My understanding in most of my discussions with the agents is STS hours are recommended at the PSI stage, as well as when we get to the point judges are offering that as an option instead of fines and in lieu of fines. But my understanding is most of the defendants are choosing the fine and not the STS. And the reason for that is, I think, just simply they see that as an easier option for them, right? I mean, if I don't pay the fine, it's going to go to collections. I don't really want to get up in the morning and go do this work. So that's part of the problem, I think, when they're given the choice, that they select a different choice than STS.
All right. Thank you.
Will that always be the option, too, for the judges? Is that going to be always what they're going to do, either STS or fine? I mean, nothing's going to change in terms of that?
So typically for the cases that I handle the higher level offenses, and I will require that as part of the plea agreement that they do community work service. Community work service isn't necessarily STS. Community work service is they need to go out and do community work service. They can work with STS, with the program, but that's not the requirement, is to do STS. But as far as the judge ordering fines or community work service, STS in lieu of the fines, they are often doing that. But I think another perspective we need to take a look at is maybe what the sheriff's seeing in the jail when inmates are coming down saying, I've been ordered to do STS or pay the fine, because he might have more insight on that.
And that was coming to that. Because one of the arguments or the problems, I will say, that's been brought up, and this is where the sheriff would come into it more, I think, is the lieu of the fine, and then they don't show up for STS, and they ain't got no money to pay the fine anyway, so they're kind of off the hook, and they don't want to tax the sheriff's department, that's a small offense, to go arrest that person and put them in jail. So there tends to be not a whole lot of teeth in that circle. Is that a fair assessment, Brian?
So say they didn't pay the fine and there's a probation violation, there's a warrant. They're not held for any length of time to have to use it. And they're going to get up the next day. And it'll be that's the revolving door that's happening right now, is there really isn't hard sanctions for not complying with a lot of stuff that the courts are doing.
Okay. And that's what I was hearing through this.
I just want to say something, just to clarify something. Brandy, when you mentioned that you community work service and STS, a while back, I remember it being that like Tammy Thompson was saying, because the county has me as a crew leader, that STS and community work service is the same thing, because we really want them to be, we want to utilize this program. And sometimes people, I don't know if you, sometimes they don't go out and, you mean, community work service, they can go wherever they want, but a lot of people in the community, if they don't, if someone goes and contacts the food shelf or the Threads of Hope, and they'll say they want to do hours, and they'll say, not if we don't hear from Mary Jean. It's kind of a safety thing for them too as well, because they don't know John Doe coming in there. They want to know a little bit about the background. And also too, I don't want, my point is that they're going in to do, because people think community work service, we in our community have community work service and STS, we try to have that the same, that I don't want just to come back as a black eye if they do something very bad because they're doing community work service or STS. So we kind of want to make sure we keep that going. Does that make sense? Because I'd like to be part of the equation, so that as a safety net for everybody, and we get their hours done and we can utilize the program. Because sometimes they find their friends to sign that they do. I mean, I don't know if they do that or whatever. We want them to be accountable. That's all.
Are these numbers including the drug court sentence to serve numbers, the community work service that the drug court candidates have to do?
That's only the people that I get.
Do you get the drug court participants?
The drug court people, yeah.
Because they're required to do a certain number of community work service in order to be able to graduate from drug court?
Yes, that's correct.
So are those numbers included in this data?
They are in this data, but they're in this data. But I don't get a lot of them. I mean, I don't get a lot of them, recipients.
Yeah, the drug court ranks typically are pretty small, in that 14 to 15 client range. And then there's a lot of other things that are happening. They're in treatment for quite a while, and things of that nature that just doesn't make them available right away to do some of this STS or community work services required. But they eventually get there and have to do that. It's just they don't come in vast numbers all at once or anything like that.
And I think it should be noted to this board that the chamber judge, Beckman, is very interested in working to ensure that STS remains a program here, but in order to ensure the county is getting a good bang for their buck, you might want to recommend that we go back and actually look at, you know, like she recommended, if there's going to be actual recommendations of STS when it comes for certain crimes, and if the public defenders is on board with that kind of, you know, just standard recommendation for a certain crime, and if that's going to be actually enforced. Because this is, you know, STS has been looked at by this county board for how many years, and we're still not having those concrete recommendations.
There's been times that it was, I just loved it when Judge Beckman would say, you're going to work community work service until you get a job. I mean, I wish that would go back to that. So rarely do I get that, because then it almost, they get job skills, they get structures, it promotes them and encourages them to get a job and fly and be a part of the community. You know, but I haven't seen them that for a while, but that was a really creative, and that's what I always tell her, thanks for your creative sentencing, but I'd like to see more of that, because if they're not working, they could that as well.
So, Brandy, what do you need from this board to address the issue that you just described? I think that's what that work group I'm sitting on too, whatever we need to do to shore up some of the loose ends or connect some of the dots so we don't have these open gaps. So whatever you need from us.
I think it was kind of already identified that maybe at the pre-sentence investigation stage it's one of those recommendations, and I think if the board directs that they take a harder look at making those part of the recommendations and then ensuring that the judge, prosecutor, and public defender or defense attorneys are on board with that as well. So it's an understanding that these are typically standard conditions.
Do you need just verbal indication from us today, or do we need to make a motion or bring this forward to the next meeting? What do we need to do?
I just identified that for this board that this has been a discussion and we're not there yet, and so I just want to put it in your hands on the direction you would like to give.
Okay. Well, I have no argument with that. I just don't know how the pretrial sentencing and all that works. So that's your area of expertise. So.
Well, and I think we can have those conversations with Les as he supervises the agents upstairs. And, he'll obviously share about the meeting today and just refocus again. Sometimes it just falls off people's radar. And I think any opportunity we have to, have the courts order STS versus community work service, at least puts them in the program. And Mary Jean, if they are not able to do the work on the crew, will find independent sites for them, which then is almost like the community work service. But it still goes, all the numbers will go into your stats here versus if they go off on their own, we're not going to know. And those stats won't be included in here.
When does the board need to make a decision on this item?
Contract is up next year, so we have, I think it's June, yeah? 30th. June 30th is the end of the next contract. So typically, I think last year we brought it forward for approval in April, May, somewhere in that range. So
we've been working on them in January.
Yeah, so we'll have about 6 months until a decision really needs to be made on it.
And I will share, because I know this is probably a question that you're all wondering, is, what type of an increase are we going to see in the next biannual contract? We have typically only passed along increases, the COLA increases for the employees and the health insurance increases. I've been looking at the program, and it's one of the things that is also grossly underfunded in community supervision. And so we are going to put forward a legislative request for funding to bring us kind of back up to where we need to be. I don't know if you know or not, but the county does not pay Mary Jean's actual salary. The contracts are based on an average of all the crew leaders' salaries, and so it's lower than what Mary Jean actually makes. And so the DOC ends up making up that difference on top of the 25 that we kick in. So it's something that needs to be brought back up to speed. We need to redo the numbers, and we don't want to pass those costs along to the counties. We want these programs to be viable, and we're going to need the legislature's assistance with that, though, or we won't have options. And frankly, I'd be scared of where the program would be if that has to be passed along to counties. So I understand the position you guys are in, and just appreciate you taking the time to look at the numbers and working with us.
have one quick question. You'd mentioned earlier you have 26 crews statewide. Is that 26 counties that have STS, or is that 26 state-run crews?
Those are state-run crews, okay. And there are a couple of counties that have more than one,
okay,
but not very many.
Okay.
Thank you.
So are you suggesting if the legislation doesn't put in make you whole, that you will have to go to the county? Is that what you're implying?
Additional costs to the county. So any support you can give us in that arena would be wonderful.
Well, I think if the recommendations follow through, it has to. Otherwise, if for STS, for me, for example, I like it in theory, but if Mary Jean or crew leader like her isn't in the county, I think it dies, because you have to have a good crew member, a crew leader, otherwise it doesn't happen, and I don't think they're utilizing it. So I think that recommendation has to happen through, like Brandy said, otherwise, you know, if it's not a combination of that and someone like Mary Jean, it dies. You know, that's my theory.
We've got to talk to these judges. We've got to talk to these folks that are, you know, in the very beginnings of someone's getting in trouble, to give them these options.
Well, can I ask the question of this board? I mean, today, and this is just unofficial, but is there anybody opposed to provide direction that Brandy identified to help us shore up this program, my men?
What wording are you proposing?
Well, I don't have it yet, but I mean, in concept. You know what I mean? The concept of providing...
I think the message is clear that we need to meet and come back and show that we have actually moved forward with just the concerns, but actually implementing the new recommendations and having those be ordered by the court. If not, I don't know how your numbers are going to keep increasing. So I think a meeting has to happen, and there needs to be action after that meeting. I think that's the clear direction.
I agree. The communication.
And that falls kind of lockstep with what this community supervision work group is looking to do as well. So.
And I think you guys received information from Judge Beckman saying she was interested in having those discussions. So it's not like we'll be stonewalled when you get to the bench.
She was aware of it, and she was supportive of it in that email. That was good.
Yeah, and that's kind of what we're seeing in the work group too. It's everybody is supportive of it, but it's fragmented and connecting, getting all parties working together. And I think the challenges are those three different tight DOC, CCA, and CPO counties, getting that message unified, and then getting it to the legislature. And I know that work group, the plan is by, I think, session is February 23rd is our drop dead date to get something put together to bring to the legislature. So we've got meetings like every 3 weeks from now till February but
very good.
There's your assignment.
Any other questions, or do you have anything additional to add? Or all right. Well, thank you.
Thank you for your support. Appreciate
that. Very good. Greg Schultz, Land Use Director.
Greg Schultz, Land Use Records Director. This morning I've got five items for on the agenda. First one is the Clint Ingrid Hedrickson final plat location, our final plat, Rasplin Ridge. This year was July 22. This was this plat was rezoned from R1 to R2. The preliminary plat was approved. Now it's in the final plat stage. Planning on making three lots out of that one lot that you see there on the map.
So this is one that we've addressed this one.
And they all meet the required minimum square footage.
Yeah, lot one is 9 acres, lot two would be 3.91 acres, and lot three would be 5.6.
More than meat.
Yeah.
Yep. All right. Do we want to take, we'll take these individually, not?
Move to approve a final plat application for the 3-lot plot of Esplin Ridge, located in Section 22, Township 119, Range 29, Parcel 07, 1047-000 of Dassel Township.
Motion by Commissioner Bredesen.
I will second that motion.
Second by Commissioner Johnson. Any further questions or discussion for Greg?
So, Greg, in this one, just to reiterate, there was one building eligibility.
Correct.
On the 18.5 acres, and then we changed it to three because part of it is partially located in the shoreline district. Was this ag land then before then? Was this a field or
before what? It was R1 before that.
Gotcha.
It went to R2. The reason why I went from R1 to R2 is we have the option of having possible horses. You know, with R2, you can have up to 2 animal units on a lot. R1, you can't have any animal units on it.
Gotcha.
You have to redesignate that.
But when they do this, they're moving from one building entitlement to three, though.
Yep, it's going from one lot, and you see that on the map, the large one, and dividing into three, which you see on the right hand side on the picture. It's going to be three lots.
And the justification for this particular one is because it is partially part of the shoreline district. The part of the property is partially located
part
within
of it is, because the justification they want to have three lots and three building eligibility rather than one.
And what is the acreage limit if you want to have a horse, two horses? What is the acreage?
Well, anything under 10 acres, we only technically have two animal units.
Okay.
So anything over 10 acres, you have a feedlot, you can have up to.
Any other discussion? If not, I call the vote. All those in favor of the Asplin application, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carried. Item B, approval conditional use permit application for Shaw Landscaping, Kingston Township.
Yeah, this would be approval of condition use permit 15942 for Jim and Tina Shaw for property located at 74536 320th Street, Southampton, Minnesota. This is on Lake Francis. They are asking for landscaping projects down by the lake, mostly a new stairwell. They got approval for a variance last month for a landing that's 8x8, which is 32 square feet larger than required ordinance. They're removing approximately about 110 cubic yards of material they brought in and moved in the shoreline this project. And you can see from the pictures it's very steep. That stairwell there, just seeing the picture on the right, is going to be replaced.
Chair, move to approve the application for a conditional use permit to move more than 10 cubic yards of material within the shore impact zone and 50 cubic yards of material in the shoreline district of recreational development Lake Francis with the conditions.
Motion by Commissioner Schiefelbein.
I will second that motion.
Second by Commissioner Johnson. Any further discussion, questions? Hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carried. Item C, approved conditional use permit application for Keekley Landscaping, Forest City Township.
The approval of conditional use permit 15957 for Kenneth and Don Keekley, property located at 2874 663 Litchfield, Minnesota. This is on Lake Richardson. And they're asking for this one. They're asking to be total cubic yardage removed or brought in. Sites should be a maximum of 150 cubic yards. Basically going to be a terracing project. It's going to be two terraces from the lake inland, as well as a little bit of terracing underneath the existing deck. There's a variance for this property, approved last month as well, for a new deck and for a gazebo. site.
All right. Look for a motion on the Keekley property.
I move to approve. Move to approve. I read it. Approval of conditional use permit 15957 for Kenneth and Don Keekley property located at 28740 660th Street, Litchfield, in the Lake Richardson Shoreline District, parcel 0904-21000.
Motion, Commissioner Bredesen.
Second.
Second, Commissioner Schiefelbein. Any further discussion or questions?
One thing that I was made aware of, and I visited with Greg earlier this morning, on the next one coming up, it says that a new septic was installed. Here on the one that we are going to currently vote on, it says that a new septic was installed in 2021. I was not aware that every time an individual, even for a landscaping project, their current septic system must be looked into, certified or...
Certified within the past 3 years when the permit was pulled.
Okay.
Yeah. I had not. You know, landscaping projects, any building project in the Shoreline District.
Okay.
So if you go in and get a permit to shingle your house.
No, not for maintenance. Not for maintenance.
Okay. See, there is that difference.
A little difference there.
Yeah.
Do you need to clarify that's for Shoreline District only or?
Shoreline District only, yes.
Okay. But with the landscaping, then that septic thing is updated. And I was pleased to hear that. Thank you.
With that, mm-hmm. All in favor of the Keekley Landscaping Project for City Township, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Motion carried. Item D, approved conditional use permit application for Ryder Landscaping, Ellsworth Township.
Approval conditional use permit 15958 from Owners Curtis and General Ryder. Applicant Mike Richardson, property located 28740 660th Street, which is in the Soil Lakes, Dallas Shoreline District, parcel 08062000. This here is going to be for a total of 286 cubic yards of material in the Shoreline District of Lake Stella. As you'll see, this is going to be four retaining walls on the existing property that they're basically replacing what's existing on the site. You see in the next picture, you'll see that. Challenging it is very steep. We're basically tearing out the old railroad ties that are there and replacing with boulder walls. So it's going to be a rather large project, and after this is done, actually what they're going to do is they're going to take down the garage for the house that's existing there now. They redo this landscaping to the point, and they're going to rebuild the house next year. That's their plan. So we kind of the two phase. Started this fall and finish it next spring.
Any questions on the project?
Move to approve an application for a conditional use permit to move more than 10 cubic yards of material within the shore impact zone and 50 cubic yards of material in the Shoreland District of the recreational development Lake Stella with the condition.
Motion, Commissioner Johnson.
Second.
Second, Commissioner Bredesen. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Motion carried. Item E, support plan amendment of North Fork Crow River Comprehensive Watershed Management Plan.
So what this is an August 3rd policy committee. It's North Fork Crow River Watershed District directed by Wake County Soil and Water Conservation District as a plan coordinator. Projects. So I've got this, we have this, and then a resolution actually came through to basically states is to support any amendments that the planning, that the policy committee recommends in the future amendments to this plan. There's no for Crow River Watershed. We're agreeing to agree with what the policy committee is going to recommend for us for the watershed district.
This is yours, isn't it, Dan?
Yeah. basically, it's just to speed things up and not have to keep going back to the board for every little item that they change. So as long as there's a policy member on the board, I think it'd be fine. But, which I am.
So is that a motion?
No. No, that wasn't a motion. That was an explanation. But to segue into that, I move to support the policy committee's recommendation to proceed with a plan amendment to the North Fork Crow River Comprehensive Watershed Management Plan.
Motion, Commissioner Schiefelbein.
Second.
Second, Commissioner Bredesen. Any further discussion, questions? Hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carried. Thank you, Greg.
Thank you.
Break time?
Yep.
It's up to you. Would you like to take a break?
I think we could take a 5-minute break. Oh, we got some little discussion items here.
Well, we have bread, too.
Yep, we've got a snack. We need a
official break. Official break. Oh, yeah. Are we ready?
Ready whenever you are.
Sucker Craig.
Okay.
It may, but I don't think so. I'd have to ask John Cotton.
Okay. I'll see if Mark has a number.
Yeah, appreciate it.
Okay, great.
2 and 3, you ready?
Sure.
We are.
All right. We're back in action here. Andrew Letson, County Administrator.
Thank you, Mr. Five. So today,
I deserve that.
Much rather be called Mr. Five than two.
Been called worse.
First item I have for you today is approval of construction management contract for the facility remodel project. As you know, we've been going through this, the design of the remodel project. Our architects in the project are World Architects in Engineering. And then as we're now moving into this next phase of design, it's beneficial for the county to engage with a construction manager at this point. The construction manager is going to be able to provide a lot of different services throughout not only the design process, but also during the construction phase. During the design phase, particularly, they'll be able to assist the architects in evaluating the constructability of design and evaluating alternatives in the event that we run into issues, but also providing valuable input on the cost estimates, you know, based on, you know, real world experience of what they're seeing out there. During the construction phase of the contract, the construction manager is going to oversee the work the contractors are doing. They're going to coordinate the contractors, ensure conformity with the plans, manage phasing to minimize disruption to our staff and our operations, and ensure that the project is completed at the best value possible. So as we, again, run into questions, concerns, issues, they'll be able to help us to identify alternatives and find that best value. In order to identify who we would want to use for construction manager, we went through a competitive process. We sent proposals to local firms, and we received two proposals back. First was from Contegrity, and the second was from ICS. Both firms were interviewed by an interdepartmental committee, which included one of our commissioners, one of your colleagues. Both firms interviewed very well. However, the committee recommended that we move forward with Contegrity as our construction manager. And there were several reasons for that. You know, we won't get into great detail about it, but ultimately there was a high level of confidence that was felt with Contegrity as we went through the interview process. Additionally, their fees were lower than what ICS was recommending. And finally, as I did the references, I got nothing but glowing responses from all of the communities who I contacted, all of my colleagues out there. The fees for the project are included in the overall project budget, which you approved at a previous meeting. And are within that amount. The total estimated fee is $585,900. Included in that is a variable fee, which is charged on a monthly basis during the course of construction. So depending on how long construction goes, that number will either grow or it'll shrink. That amount is $28,000 and change per month. There is a fixed base fee of $180,000 that's included in that total $585,000 as well. So as we get to the point of construction, we'll have a better sense of knowing what our schedule is going to look like and what that total fee is going to come out to be. As of right now, we do have a little bit of wiggle room within the budget to absorb some additional time that would be necessary. So with that, I would recommend approval of proposal from Contegrity Group, and I'm available for any questions that you may have.
I see they had, I see they had done a small project for Meeker County.
They did, yes. The probation remodel that occurred in 2020, I believe, up on level 5, they did the construction management for that. Joel worked with them closely on that project, and he had good experience with them.
I also saw that they did the Wright County $42 million project.
They did, and so I had a conversation with my counterpart in Wright County, and he was certainly one of the people who spoke very glowingly of Contegrity, you know, talking a lot about finding value in different things that, you know, where things wouldn't have to necessarily be, you know, reordered or finding, you know, materials. You know, Commissioner Johnson, as you recall, when we went through and did the tour of that facility, we had a discussion about the wall material. And, you know, they wanted a certain look, and they were able to, the construction manager was able to help them find a material that was of a lesser cost but had a similar look and durability. So those were the types of things that they had talked about.
I believe, if I recall right, that McLeod County, the Joan Claus building, their new center, their new building down there that they remodeled, I think that was a Contegrity project.
That was also a Contegrity project as well.
Because I believe they were starting on that, and that some conversations, I think it was between Commissioner Olberg and Commissioner Kruger down there, that is why we chose Contegrity to try him on that probation project a few years, if I recall them events properly. I think that's all that.
Yep, and received positive comments about that project as well.
And so we have seen the Wright County completed project. We've seen the, well, I don't know if you have, Commissioner Schiefelbein and I saw the Glencoe one. Both were, I thought, were very good quality.
Yeah, and Commissioner Kruger was real high on them, too. He's pretty conservative in terms of the bottom line. And I had talked to him before we even did Wold, and he said, well, hopefully you get Contegrity as your. So I'm pretty confident now.
The variable fees, it says that was $28,000 a month is correct, the estimate for that.
Mm-hmm.
So this $405,000.
Mm-hmm.
Could go down,
yes,
if it's constructed more quickly,
yes,
or it could go up if there are situations that cause them to go beyond the 18-month construction period, or
mm-hmm,
so that when it says variable, that means.
Yes, so I misspoke. Yeah. It's about $22,000. Included in that is $18,750 for the on-site supervision, which is, you know, them being on-site. There's $3,200 a month in travel and mileage costs, as well as a job site trailer. If we're able to find them space somewhere within our buildings where they don't need to have a construction management trailer, that they have a space that they can work out of, then that cost wouldn't necessarily need to be incurred. So, yeah, it truly is. It's the cost to have them here. They're not going to charge us for time that they're not here. So if construction isn't occurring, then that is, if that project hasn't actually started construction yet, then they're not going to charge us for that. And if it finishes early, they're not going to charge us for additional time. But certainly, this is where phasing of the project is going to come in and impact us. And where we're going to have conversations with, you know, them and the architects and our staff to determine how do we want to phase the project to minimize disruption to our customers. Because we can do little bits here and there and have very little disruption, but it's going to extend the time of the contract. Or we can do a lot, have a lot of disruption, it's going to really shorten it. So there's a balance that we're going to have to find there.
It just makes me nervous when it says variable. Is this something that could get to be a bigger number? Or, I mean, I'm assuming weather can play into this and availability of materials and.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and so part of the scheduling of how all of this works as well is that there's going to be a process where we go out to bids, and there are certain things that are going to take longer to procure than others. And the idea is that you order those things right away, even if they come later in the project, so that you're not sitting around waiting for materials. So, you know, as we get into the design and get more of a sense of what that actual schedule is going to look like, we'll have a better sense of what that cost is going to be. Okay. We're still a little early in right now. We've estimated 18 months. What we were told during the interview process is that's doable, but it's a little aggressive. Mm-hmm. So it may come out to be a little bit more than that, but again, we will have several conversations about this with you prior to the point of going out to bid on this project.
Okay. So Wald had estimated this would cost $615,000 then? Is that what?
Yeah, the $30,000? The fixed fees, so if you recall in the overall project budget, there's I think $950,000-ish of fixed fees that were in there. A portion of that was Wold's design cost of $746,000. And then the balance was intended to be for the fixed fees for the construction manager. So we are under that. The variable fees is baked into the construction cost because they're basically acting as the general contractor on our behalf.
Gotcha. So that fixed fee number actually is the $30,000. They had yes. $210,000.
Yep.
So the variable, gotcha.
Yep.
That's a little more relieving, I guess.
I had the exact same question that you did when I pulled these numbers together, and it was a little bit of a shock to me, but you know, in having conversations with them, you know, learning that this was the variable fee was included in that construction, that per square foot construction cost, provide a lot more comfort.
Yeah.
All right.
Where are they located?
Little Falls.
Little Falls. There it says Little Falls. Okay.
Anything else for Andrew?
Chair, I'll move to approve the proposal from Contegrity Group of Little Falls, Minnesota for the construction management services related to the facility remodel project via a contract that is found acceptable by the county attorney.
Motion, Commissioner Schiefelbein.
Second.
Second, Commissioner Bredesen. Any further discussions or questions for Andrew? Hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carried. Item B, preliminary 2023 levy and budget.
Okay. So much of the information that you're going to see is what we've discussed with the work session today, but I'm going to run through it for the public who may be watching this. So where we are at right now as far as our 2023 annual budget, comparing to 2022, our total expenditures in 2023 are $58,011,649. Included in that is $9.1 million in transfers moving from one fund into another. So our net expenditures, the amount that we're going to spend, is actually $48.869 million. Total revenue is at $62.4 million. The same number is transferred into funds. And then we have about $9 million in estimated fund balance that we're going to use. So our net revenue, which is the taxes and fees and other revenues that we collect, is $44,339,000. Looking at it on a fund-by-fund basis, what this chart shows is that in the general fund, we're anticipating using $20.2 million, the road and bridge fund, $11.2 million, human services, $9.8 million, parks, $442,000, solid waste, $1.8 million, regional library, $260,000, public health, $1.5 million, family services, $715,000, capital projects, $7.78 million, and our debt service, $4.2 million. That's how we get to our bottom line total expenditures. We do have a net positive balance on our revenues compared to our expenditures. And first off, that's largely driven by, in the capital projects fund, the issuance of a bond in 2023 to pay for the facility remodel project that we just discussed. And in our solid waste fund, the change in the way that we've operated the transfer station, rather than having the contractor receive all the revenue and pay out all the expenses, now that is all being done by the county, is anticipated to have a $182,000 net benefit to that fund. Looking at our operating versus our capital expenses, in 2023, we're anticipating to have $34 million in total operating expenditures, which is an increase of $3.3 million over the previous year. Capital expenditures, $14.9 million compared to $6.5 million, which is an increase of $8.4 million. So what you see is largely the increase in our budget is driven by this increase in capital expenditures, these one-time expenses. Largely, it's the facility project, but also it's highway construction that's occurring. In our use of fund balance, we anticipate using $4.2 million out of the general revenue fund. $3.8 million of this is money that's coming from the general fund to go into the capital projects fund for the building remodel project, but also for other capital projects that are occurring in this year. $655,000 in the human services fund. In our capital projects fund, we have $3.2 million of American Rescue Plan dollars that will be used this year. This will be the balance of our ARP funding. $800,000 for capital projects, which is for the roof of the courthouse and the law enforcement center. $26,000 out of the family services fund to pay for capital work there. $24,000 out of public health and $30,000 out of the regional library, which is how we get to our $8.9 million bottom line for fund balance use. Transferring those funds, total of $5 million from the general revenue fund into capital projects, parks, and public health. The parks and public health is our annual appropriation from the general fund into those different funds. As you recall, we always, rather than levying dollars directly into the parks and the public health funds, we levy those dollars into the general fund and then transfer them into those funds. We also have money from the family services building fund going into capital projects, $179,000, which is for capital work at that building. And then $3.95 million from debt service to capital projects. That's that issuance of that bond. As we look at the property tax change for next year, bottom line here is that the preliminary levy that we're proposing is $16.22 million at total change, percentage change of 3%. As we look to move forward from here, our next steps are on December 1st at 6 p.m. We're going to have our truth and taxation meeting, and then we're going to potentially look to adopt the budget on December 8th. With that, I'm available for any questions that you might.
Any questions for Andrew?
When is the, I thought the human services were going to put $1 million into that. Is that all coming in 2024, or how does that work? Out of their fund balance, because they didn't show that for 2023.
Correct, yes.
Okay, is there a reason behind that, why it's delayed to 2024, or is it something with the county numbers, or
no,
why?
I think ultimately it's something that we could do in 2023 as we were going through, as I was going through this with Paul. You know, we had, you know, not identified that in this year, but we certainly could.
Gotcha. I just didn't know if there's something where you could get more reimbursement that way.
Yeah.
If that wasn't the case, it was just gotcha. Doesn't affect the levy.
No,
but at all. But it's just general information.
Any other questions on budget and levy for Andrew? You got that look on your face, Julie.
Yeah, I make little notes, and usually if I just sit tight, all those questions get answered if I just pay attention.
We're about done sitting for today, so if you got one, you better bring it forward, though.
I think I'm fine. I read through Andrew's budget adjustment letter. I had a few questions on that, but I think I'm good.
Okay. Yep. With that, I'd look for a motion.
So I move to set the preliminary 2023 net levy at $16,220,310, which represents a 3% increase over 2022.
Motion, Commissioner Bredesen.
Second.
Second, Commissioner Schiefelbein. Any further discussion or questions?
I know this is beating a dead horse, but it seems like we're tapping into our reserves. This is not a firm percentage at this time. We've got 4 months to go. Last year we set our preliminary levy higher and then shot for the lower one. This year we're giving ourselves no wiggle room except to go back into our reserves if something comes back. we've got a lot of balls in the air right now. I don't know if I will support this motion.
All right.
What would you recommend changing, Paul?
I just would have given ourselves a cushion on that levy. I still would like to see 3%, but we have till December to bring it to that. Right now, we're saying, we're stuck at 3. This is where it's going to be. We can't go up. That's my only concern. Last year, I believe, Andrew, correct me if I'm wrong, 2.5 was our original, and we settled at 1.5.
I believe so.
We gave ourselves a percentage cushion last year. This year, we're giving ourselves no cushion to go to December with several items that we're still working on. That's my only concern. I like to have some room. Okay? If the sky doesn't fall in, we're great. We're perfect. We go 3 in December and it's over. That's just my only concern.
Well, and just keep in mind that's the ceiling.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's the ceiling.
This is the ceiling right here. It's the ceiling.
So. And I will say, as we were working through the budget process, that was a question in my mind too at one point, where to come in at. But after discussions with the gentleman that came in and talked bonds with us,
Chuck,
after his conversations and the percentages and things like that, I'm comfortable with the 3%.
I will be comfortable with 3% in December if we don't have any changes between now and then. I'll be very comfortable with it. I don't want to increase taxes one dime more than we have to.
No.
But by the same token, I just don't like always going to our reserves.
All right. Anything else? With that, I'll call the vote. And this is not a resolution, correct? I'll call the vote. All in favor of setting the 2023 net levy at $16,220,310, which represents a 3% increase over 2022, please say aye.
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 Opposed?
Aye.
Motion carried 3-1. Administrator's report.
Just as a reminder, we have a work session next Tuesday.
What's on it?
We're going to have 3 items to discuss on next week's work session. We're going to have a discussion about the sheriff's budget request. We're going to have a discussion about the 5-year highway plan. And as part of our website redesign that we're engaging in right now, it's an opportunity for us to take a look at our logo and decide, do we want to continue on with what we have, or do we want to do something different? So we're going to have a couple of options for you to take a look at and get your feedback and see if we want to continue on that process.
Good. Committee reports. Start on my right.
All the way down here. It's been quiet. We had the health insurance committee, which reviewed the dental. We've already acted on that, so there's no point in bringing forth anything there. I had a PAC meeting in Wilmer on the 14th. Our executive director, Rochelle Peterson, is resigning. She's opening her own business. She's been there a number of years. She's been great. She's been a really good executive director, but I'm one of these folks who thinks that change is just a good thing. Now we'll take a look and maybe we'll shake it up a little bit and head a little bit different direction and have a little different leadership. So that was good. AMC and Alex, well, that's always fun. Tax capacity presentation by the gentleman from Aiken was very interesting. And I see that Andrew sent out the email showing how we came in next to the other ones in property values, which continues to be a big discussion. And learn from him that people, we need to break that down. I need to be able to break that down in my head so I can explain it better when somebody asks me about it. I was on transportation and infrastructure, and I'm going to take this opportunity to once again thank Meeker Cooperative for Vibrant. Because that took up one half day talking about broadband in the state of Minnesota. And here we sit in Meeker County, and we are so well taken care of. And you know, The second half of that discussion was about finding ways and platform to have permanent financing to our highways rather than this wait and see that we tend to play each year. So, but that was it. Great food, big meatballs.
Good.
Julie,
it's you.
Okay. Well, of course, starting out the month, back on the 6th, we had a regular meeting. Then that same week, on the 8th, I traveled to Hutchinson. Beth was with me. We did the Meeker McLeod Sibley Public Health meeting. That was on the 8th. We had a very nice presentation about the SHIP program, which is an acronym for State Health Improvement Partnership. We have a lady here who represents Meeker County. Her name is Pam Bagley. She did a really nice job making her presentation about all of the projects that she's involved with the SHIP program. It was well done.
You're putting a lot of emphasis on that P.
Partnership.
Yeah. Let's be thankful she is.
I'm not criticizing.
No, she did a very good job. This committee is conducting employee reviews. We were updated on the grant awards, and things were in order. Andrew had been sent an email about surplus furniture information, and there's some pictures of all the surplus furniture. Like a year or so ago, I don't know if it was Sibley County, whichever one purchased all kinds of new equipment, or chairs and tables and desks and et cetera, and then they never used them. So they're sitting in our warehouse here, and those pieces of furniture need to be dispersed. And I know Brian just left, but he had put in a request of, what, $9,000-some for furniture for the sheriff's department, and I'm hoping that between you fellows that maybe some of that can be taken a look at if it could meet some of their needs.
So I put in a note saying that we would be interested in all of it, because with our facility remodel project,
sure.
I don't know what all of that stuff is going to look like, but we would be able to find use for it, I'm 100% certain. I have not received a response on that.
Oh, okay. Very good.
But I know all three counties expressed interest.
Yep. They were going to be taking a look at that. Okay, thank you. I wanted to touch base on that. Let's see. Today is the 20th. Tomorrow, Wednesday, I have the local public health meeting. That'll be over here at our social services. And hopefully we will get to meet our new doctor, Dr. Whitney. I don't know if it's Rents is how you pronounce her name. She will also then become our local public health board chair. She'll be taking Dr. Searle's place because of his retirement. So that's tomorrow morning. Then on the 27th, we'll have our work session. Andrew expressed the three topics there. Then on the 27th that afternoon, we have a U of M, University of Minnesota Extension meeting out at the fairgrounds. And the crop naturalist person who had been here working, he has taken another career path. So we will begin working through another hiring process to replace that crop naturalist person. And then also on the 27th, Barb mentioned we have our 5 o'clock Dassel Ditch meeting, and that will round out the month.
Just remember, it's not at the History Center. It's at
on the other side of town, yeah. City Hall meeting. That's it for me.
Number four?
No. Number four, like I said, it's a lot better than number two.
Hey.
Well, hey. You know, yeah. You have to think about it. So I had an EDA meeting with Steve, and then we agreed to what is that where we what's the exact thing that's called, really?
You're talking about the
housing, and in terms of what kind of housing Meeker County needs.
The housing study
yes.
That's where
we voted to approve a housing study for Meeker County.
It costs $34,000, and then it's prorated the county pays half, and then each community that participates pays based on per capita. And they only had, I think, Grove City, Cosmos, and Darwin that they hadn't heard back from, but they're a very small dollar amount.
So. Will Litchfield be?
Yes.
They will
yes.
be participating. Okay.
And it's they've done it like 5 years ago.
2016, I think, 16. Wasn't it?
And actually, Joe Keekley, who's a developer that sits on ADA from Watkins, spoke to it probably more than, well, definitely spoke to it more than anybody else, but he said they do use a lot of that data okay. when they come into a community. He said there's a lot of information in them housing studies that provides the builders with help cut some corners on their expenses coming in if they already have that data. So it is helpful. So we did vote for that and to participate in that study.
That was the gist of that's that was what I thought the biggest thing yep. of EDA was. And then I had to speak at Kingston Lions. They asked me to come there. So that's it.
And how did that speech go?
Oh. Well, yeah, my topic was all over the board, if you can imagine that. So, no.
About the board?
No, no. It was all positive.
Oh,
positive
wait a minute. Stuff.
Just about number two.
Yeah, I'm not going to elaborate on number two.
Picking up number two.
But no. Oh, okay. It's about 30 minutes. So, just talking about what the county's doing as far as things. And I talked about the remodeling and trying to set a levy and stuff and what we did last year and our what our struggles are of trying to fill positions in the sheriff's office. And but on the positive side, that we're trying to put more individuals on the public works in terms of snow plows and stuff like that, which is always the biggest two concerns for everybody is, or three. How much is it going to cost me? How are my roads are going to be? And is it going to be safe in the county? I mean, so I kind of hit those three subjects and talked about the remodeling and why it's been a long thing coming that they've been talking about it 10 years. And everybody seemed pretty receptive about it. So
this was the Kingston Lions?
Yeah, there's about 20 people. I think Randy spoke there before. One person nice. Asked how it is. Yeah. Working with your sister, being that she's above you. And I was like, well, I don't know about that hierarchy regardless. Yeah. I'm her uncle. Family hierarchy goes above county hierarchy. And then they all agreed with that. And then that was...
Meeting adjourned,
exactly. So, no, it was good. It's good to actually talk to people. And actually, they had questions and stuff. And it's a nice little forum. But that's it.
On that note, I could make mention, Barb was here earlier. Last week, Barb was the presenter for, it's called WELCA. It's the women's organization of the church that I belong to here in town. And there were about 20 ladies that attend that, and Barb was our primary presenter. And she gave information to all of us on elections, all the struggles that have happened in the last couple of years, how they're moving forward. She explained the differences between, early voting and ballots and mail-in and everything. And she had a really informative, well-done presentation. And I was going to go down now after the meeting and thank her for that, but I thought I'd mention it here as well. She did an excellent job, represented us well.
You said you were going to go down there?
Yeah.
But you're not going to anymore?
Oh, I think I will.
No.
She has candy in her office. Yeah. But yeah, kudos to Barb.
I was just going to mention one thing on, you mentioned snow plowing and stuff too, and I thought Phil brought up a good point in that discussion we had a week or two ago that the public perception or the public demands of service have changed so much over the years, when it comes to snow plowing. So I do think that they are receptive to us adding positions or full-time operators and keeping people in the seat.
Yeah, they get it, too, that it's harder to have part-timers versus full-timers, not knowing the operation of the equipment itself.
Yeah. For myself, we already touched on EDA. I also had Central Minnesota Jobs and Training. Some of the things we talked about there, on average, there are 14 facilities service about 69,000 people a year on average. In 08, that jumped to 247,000 people per year. And it hasn't really dipped much below to 69,000. There was kind of that 69,000-70,000 prior to 08, and then it jumped way up, and then it dipped back down, but it's still in that range of about 70,000, but they are starting to see that climbing. They are getting more people in recently. Another note there, they did their Cambridge office was broken into, and they stole a bunch of computers, printers, drilled into the safe, and then they must have had ADD or something because they got sidetracked by something that was shiny in the window in the business next to them, so they went into there. And anyway, short, long story short, they're able to track the trail of junk that they carried out of there across to a housing development and track them down. So it was kind of a entertaining note. Then I talked already a lot with the presentation today from DOC on what we talked about in public safety up at AMC and Arrowwood last week. Just there's a lot of struggles in public safety, and that's going to be a continuing conversation on how to tie the loose ends up there and get funding where it needs to be and get the segments of the organizations from the judges to the probations supporting one another. Then I had Grove City Care, and everything seems to be operating relatively smoothly over there. That's coming up. That's coming up next Monday, so I'll have Grove City Care and then a work session. So other than that, I don't have a whole lot.
I was looking at some of our information, and now coming up on October 25th, the Association of Minnesota Counties is going to be meeting here in Litchfield in our courthouse. What will the board?
District 5.
Yeah. What will the responsibilities be?
24th.
Banana bread. 25th.
Correct, Andrew?
It's the 24th.
Fourth is a Monday. So what did I write? I got it on my calendar, but I got the wrong date here. Thank you. Yeah, it'll be Monday, the 24th. Are there any responsibilities on our part that we need to be aware of?
Banana bread.
Oh, I can do that.
And a lot of it.
Okay.
Just to attend.
And it's casual dress.
Yep.
Okay,
so it's not.
Yeah, there's no other responsibility that
we have
to be there and
40 people probably-ish.
Yeah, it depends.
Yeah, but I mean, roughly.
If harvest is really moving, then it'll be a little less.
But we don't have to prepare any speeches or anything.
Well, you could.
Typically what they do is they ask for an update on things that are going on in the county. They'll reach out in advance and kind of let you know, or let me know and you know, what kind of the topics they're looking for, you know, feedback on, and then I can help prepare some comments. And typically what's happened in the past is that I've been forced to go up there and give those comments. Come along with me. Choose not to.
I did one here, but
yeah.
Before you.
He wasn't here.
I know.
He didn't go to that one.
Yeah. I did have one other thing, too, I forgot to mention. Minnesota Rural Counties, the executive director, Dan Larson, has announced he is resigning. Not retiring, but resigning. He's heading on a little bit different avenue, something that he's worked on in the past. So he will be resigning effective the end of the year. And so they are appointed a kind of a search committee, if you will, to look for a new executive director. But I have a feeling that I have more than a feeling that I would make a request that Meeker exit that program at the end of the year. I had asked for a year last December, I believe. Mm-hmm. And I think we're going to move on AMC as other avenues, I think, that are more viable for us and save us $2,500 in expenses a year. So but.
When will that decision have to be made? Now, December?
I think we pay it in like February. Yeah, February. It's the first part of the year, so. With that, I'll adjourn the meeting.
Anything else? I don't think so.
Thank you, Chair Olberg, for a wonderful meeting.